thankful to be in the house of the Lord. While you're standing, I want to go right ahead and direct your attention to Matthew chapter 24. And we're going to look once more to Matthew chapter 24. It recounts one of the most important prophecies in the Bible. And what we're going to do tonight in the reading of our verses is I'm going to read verse 1. We're going to alternate the reading. I'll read verse 1. The congregation will read verse 2. I will read verse 3. Congregation, verse 4. We will alternate down to verse 13. And then together, we will read verse 42. So we'll alternate. I'll read verse 1. You'll read verse 2. We'll alternate. Go down to verse 13. And then together, we will read verse 42. Matthew chapter 24, beginning at verse number 1, the Bible says, "And Jesus went out and departed from the temple, and his disciples came to him for to show him the buildings of the temple. And as he sat upon the Mount of Olives, the disciples came unto him privately, saying, Tell us, when shall these things be? And what shall be the sign of thy coming and of the end of the world? For many shall come in my name, saying, I am Christ, shall deceive many.
And ye shall hear of wars and rumors of wars. See that ye be not troubled. For all these things must come to pass, but the end is not yet.
For nation shall rise against nation, and kingdom against kingdom. And there shall be famines and pestilences and earthquakes in divers places.
All these have the beginning of sorrows.
Then shall they deliver you up to be afflicted, and shall kill you. Ye shall be hated of all nations for my name's sake. And many false prophets shall arise, and shall deceive many. But he that shall endure unto the end, the same shall be saved. Verse 42 together. Watch therefore, for ye know not what hour your Lord doth come. Father, we're grateful, we're thankful for a touch of heaven, the presence of God that is here. We are grateful that, God, we know you're here tonight, God, because you want to continue to minister and to strengthen and to help your people. I pray that, God, for the next few moments, you would open the understanding of your people. I pray and plead the blood of Jesus over this service in this setting. We pray in Jesus' name. You may be seated. Amen. It's so good to be here tonight and to know that God is still moving. Amen. Often we come on Wednesdays and we just think it's just going to be a slow pace. And we think that it's just going to kind of be the same old, same old. Can I tell you, when it comes to the God that we serve, you don't know what he's going to do and how he's going to do it. But I thank the Lord that he's moving, that he's in this service tonight, and we're grateful. Now, again, this passage of scripture that we read tonight is part of a powerful message, sermon, that was preached by the Lord Jesus Christ on the Mount of Olives. And as I've alluded to, amen, as I mentioned last week, amen, as we live in days like none before, the signs of Jesus' return are everywhere you look. Amen. I said everywhere you look, the signs of his return are there. And then we go again to Mark chapter 13, scripture text that I read last Wednesday Amen. Where Jesus again is, amen, sharing prophetic, powerful insight, amen, advice for our lives today. Mark chapter 13 and verse 32. He says, but of that day and that hour knoweth no man. No, not the angels which are in heaven, neither the Son, but the Father. Verse 33. Take ye heed, watch and pray, for ye know not when the time is. For the Son of Man is as a man taking a far journey, who left his house and gave authority to his servants and to every man his work. And he commanded the porter to watch. Watch ye therefore, for ye know not when the master of the house cometh. At evening, at even or at midnight, or at the cock crowing, or in the morning, lest coming suddenly, he find you sleeping. And what I say unto you, I say unto all, watch. There's some things we're going to have to do if we're going to stay in right standing with God. We talked about Sunday being surrounded by the favor of God. Now, you know, I don't know if you really have been, I know a lot of times people don't pay attention, but I hope you have been paying attention. It's been for several months that I've been indicating that this church, we've been in a season of praise. Yes. Yes. Amen. But I've come to tell you, we've kind of moved into a new season. Amen. It's fall, naturally. I hope you've adjusted. Amen. Soon it'll be winter. But we're still somewhat in a season of praise, but there's another season that we're in. It's a season of favor. Amen. It's a season of favor. Amen. And if the enemy would have his way, he will depress you, frustrate you, distract you, discourage you, whatever he can do to make you think and believe that you are not in a season of favor. Amen. You need to start expecting great things to happen. You need to start expecting doors to open that land and the sea and kick people. Amen. But to get in that favor flow, you got to stay in right standing with God. There's some things we got to do to stay in right standing. We talked about last week about this subject we talk about here tonight, watch. To be in right standing, you got to watch your words. You cannot just say whatever you want to say, when you want to say it, how you want to say it, and where you want to say it. If you want to stay in right standing with God and stay in the flow of the favor of God, amen, you got to watch your tongue.
Amen.
You just can't blabber out and just speak whatever you want to say. Just because somebody get on your nerves, you just can't just say whatever you want to say. Amen. But now you got to also understand, on top of watching your words, we got to watch our attitude. Mm-hmm. That's what we'll talk about tonight. Watch your attitude. According to the dictionary, the word attitude means an internal position or feeling with regards to something else, i.e. a person or a thing. Other words often used as synonyms for attitude are words such as disposition, feeling, mood, opinion, sentiment, temper, tone, perspective, frame of mind, outlook, view, or morale. And it's interesting when we talk about all these things, there's so many illustrations I could use to make points, but there's one I want to use tonight. I don't know if you know this, but that airplane pilots, while flying, they often use AI. That's right. Now, I'm not talking about artificial intelligence. Some of us hear AI, we think of artificial intelligence. But I'm not talking about AI from the aspect of artificial intelligence. I'm speaking about AI, what pilots use, and it's actually literally called attitude indicators. And these attitude indicators that are in the planes, they describe, while flying, the horizontal relationship of the plane with the runway. when they land. And if the plane's AI or attitude indicator isn't aligned properly, the plane will make contact with the ground at a wrong angle, therefore causing the plane to crash. Now, in essence, our attitude, somebody say my attitude. Our attitude is our inward disposition toward other things such as people, other things such as circumstances, other things such as events that happen in our life. And as in with an airplane, your attitude is applied whenever you must deal with something other than yourself. Amen. Amen. But I love the fact that God's word teaches us, according to God's word, when we become a child of God. Anybody happy to be a child of God? Anybody happy to be saved? Amen. It's not a boring thing to be saved. Amen. It's not something that's going to cramp your style. Amen. To be saved. Amen. You get saved, you really will get some real spiritual swag. Praise God. Amen. Some people look at being saved as if I get saved, I won't have no swag. I don't know why people look at living for God as such a boring thing. There is nothing boring about living for God.
That's right.
Amen. People look at what we do and think that what we do is crazy. There's nothing crazy, weird about how we worship God. There's nothing weird, crazy about how we clap our hands to God, how we dance, how we fall out on the floor, roll, speak in tongues. There's nothing crazy, weird, out of place about that. What's weird and crazy, my wife and I were in the car the other day, and I had to go to my job to take care of something and happened to go down there on game day. And didn't realize that, amen, the Panthers were playing. And you had hundreds upon hundreds of people all walking with the same jersey, same color. I mean, hundreds upon hundreds of people. Crowds, I mean, just standing in massive lines trying to get in restaurants. And I thought to myself, they think what we do crazy. What they doing is crazy. I mean, and then, I mean, if to park, $50 to park. I said, in my mind, I'd take my parking garage that I pay monthly and on game day let people park and say, you want to park? Hey, $50, I'll let you in. $150, right? My garage is a whole lot closer. Amen. And where these people paying? I'm like, man, this is crazy. But, you know, the world looks at that like, wow, that's great. But what we do, oh, it don't take all that. It don't take all that to stand outside of a restaurant, wait 30 minutes, massive crowds of people. Well, anyhow, let me get off that. Amen. They still losing. Amen. Jesus has never lost a battle. Amen. But you see, according to the word of God, when we become a child of God, a Christian, born again of the water and of the Spirit, amen, baptized in his name, according to Acts chapter 2, verse 38, amen, a part of our new creation is the development of a new attitude.
Right.
Amen. Our attitude, after we get saved, our attitude should become more like that of Jesus. Amen. Amen. You see, the Bible tells us that our attitude should be the same as that of Jesus Christ. Amen. And the Lord would not tell us to do something that was impossible. Amen. Philippians chapter 2, verse 5 in the Amplified Complete Version. It says in Philippians chapter 2, verse 5 from the Amplified Complete, it says, let this same attitude and purpose and humble mind be in you, which was in Christ Jesus. Let him be your example in humility. He says, let this same attitude and purpose and humble mind be in you. You look in the book of Ephesians chapter 4, beginning at verse 24, and I'm going to read from the Amplified Complete. Ephesians chapter 4, verse 22. In the Amplified Complete, verse 22, Paul says, strip yourselves of your former nature. Strip yourselves of your former nature. Put off and discard your old, unrenewed self, which is characterized by, or characterized, which characterized your previous manner of life, and becomes corrupt through lust and desires that spring from delusion. That is so powerful. That one verse in that translation alone is powerful. He says, strip yourself of your former nature. Put it off. Get rid of it. That unrenewed man, that unrenewed woman, get rid of it.
Right.
Which characterized your previous manner of life. You know that old life.
Yeah.
That old way of doing things. That a lot of what we did, he said, it was done through lust,
right,
and desires that really sprang up from just us being delusioned, yeah, or deceived. Look at verse 23. And be constantly renewed in the spirit of your mind, having a fresh mental and spiritual attitude.
Yes.
Verse 24, and put on the new nature. The regenerated self, created in God's image, Christ, God-like, in true righteousness and holiness. And put on the new nature, the regenerated self, created in God's image, God-like, in true righteousness and holiness. Let me just throw this in there. I truly believe with all my heart that when an individual gets a refreshed, renewed, mental and spiritual attitude, the struggles that people have with their flesh, with righteousness and holiness, won't be so difficult.
Right.
You know why it's so difficult for people to live a righteous and godly and a holy life? Because their mind hasn't been regenerated.
Right.
They have the wrong attitude about holiness.
Right.
They have the wrong attitude about righteousness and godliness.
Yeah.
Because when you get your mind renewed and you start having the mind of Christ, you don't have no problem taking something off.
Right.
You don't have no problem putting something on.
Right.
Because your mind has been regenerated. But when a mind has not been regenerated, that old nature likes to buck against,
yeah,
kick against, yeah, the things of God and what God is trying to tell you to do with your life.
That's right.
Amen.
Amen.
Amen. I believe with all my heart.
Yes,
amen.
Yes.
Somebody say, you got to watch my attitude.
Now,
most of us can easily identify bad attitudes when they are displayed outwardly in others. And in our own words and attitudes, we should be able to identify bad attitudes. You got to watch your attitude. There, God's anointing and favor won't flow through your life and on your life if you walk around all the time with a bad attitude.
Amen.
Amen. Amen. Bad attitudes. What are some bad attitudes? Negativeness is a bad attitude. Criticalness. Some people are just always critical of any and everything. Critical about anything that happens in life. You don't want to get so critical that you criticize and get critical of everything. Amen. God be trying to bless you and you get critical of what he's doing in your life. Amen. Rebellion is a bad attitude. rebellion. Bible said rebellion is as the sin as witchcraft. Amen. The sin of witchcraft. God compares rebellion to witchcraft. Amen. It's a bad attitude. Defiance is a bad attitude. Amen. You ever known anybody who was just defiant? Amen. Impatient can be a bad attitude. Amen. Uncooperative is a bad attitude. Apathy is a bad attitude. Discouragement can be a bad attitude. Independence. I don't need nobody. I'll do it myself. It's a bad attitude. Amen. Presumption is a bad attitude. Arrogance is a bad attitude. Self-centeredness is a bad attitude. Rudeness is a bad attitude. Amen. And these are all examples, and I could go on and list a whole lot more, but these are attitudes that we need to watch, attitudes that we need to reject. Because I'm going to tell you something, these bad attitudes will put a weight on you.
Yes, sir.
It'll put a yoke on you. It'll weigh you down. It'll steal your joy. Steal your praise. Amen. Amen. You got to reject these things. Amen. However, keep in mind, attitudes are the inward. Somebody say inward.
Inner.
They're the inner, inward dispositions of one's heart and thoughts. They are the hidden intentions, which will eventually serve as the basis of our actions. That's why Solomon said in Proverbs 23, verse 7, the very beginning of that chapter, verse, Proverbs 23, verse 7, for as he thinketh in his heart, so is he. But the reality I think we all have to come to grips with and realize and understand is that no one else really knows your thoughts that are in your heart except you and God. Amen. And according to scripture, our attitude toward life, our attitude toward circumstances, toward one another, should always be like the Lord's. Amen. We're going to have favor. We got to get the mind of Christ. Amen. And this is a season of favor. But we got to watch what we say. Amen. We got to watch our attitude. Stuff will happen in life that'll rub you the wrong way. Amen. So I ain't never had nothing rub me the wrong way. Just keep living. Just keep going to school. Just keep working. Something will rub you the wrong way.
That's right.
People will just, as they would say, irk you. Just get under your skin. Amen. But you got to keep the right attitude. Amen. You might feel like you're being overlooked, but you got to keep the right attitude. Amen. Praise God. Amen. You feel like people don't recognize you. You just got to keep the right attitude. Amen. I had a situation that recently happened on my job where, amen, some things were being said, recognition was being brought out, and you know, they didn't mention my name. Not for the recognition, but being a part of the team. But I didn't take it personally. Amen. I just thought maybe, you know, oversight. You know, I don't know what's going on in their mind. But even in the midst of that, I just kept the right spirit, and all of a sudden, oh man, what am I thinking about? I was supposed to tell you, you need to be up here too. You know, but you know, I didn't take it the wrong way. You know, some of us, I mean, just, you know, some of you just get rubbed the wrong way. But just, I mean, if the wind blows a certain way, you got to get over that stuff. If you're going to find God's favor, you got to get over this stuff.
Right.
Amen. Somebody said, I got to get over some stuff. Amen. Now, let's talk about some things as it relates to our attitude to God. What should our attitude be like to God? Well, our attitude to God should be that of reverence. Amen. You need to have an attitude of reverence to God. An attitude of submission to God. An attitude of love. An attitude of trust. An attitude of humbleness to God. An attitude of obedience to God. An attitude of worship to God. Amen. An attitude of prayerfulness to God. These are the attitudes that we need to have to God. Amen. If we want to stay in alignment and stay in position, amen, to find the favor of God. You just can't treat God like your best friend. Amen. You just don't treat God like, amen, you know, some distant cousin. You treat God with reverence. You treat God with respect. Amen. Submission and obedience. Amen. And amen. Don't go blaming God. Amen. Don't get mad. You know, a lot of people get mad at God. Amen. Don't get mad at God. Don't take out what you think you're going through on God.
Amen.
Amen. Amen. We need to love him and trust him and know that all things work together for the good of them that love God. That's the kind of attitude we need to have toward God. And all these things that I'm sharing, I wish I had time. I could share you many scriptures of all the things that I'm talking about. But then let's talk about our attitude to God's children. Our attitude to one another, our attitude to other believers. Yeah, amen. 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 God is concerned about our attitude. Amen. To one another.
Right,
our attitude to other believers.
Amen.
See, our attitude should be that of love.
Amen.
To one another.
Yeah, right.
Amen. Our attitude toward others in the body of Christ should be an attitude of forgiveness.
Amen.
Amen. An attitude of consideration.
Yeah.
Amen. Don't just consider yourself and yourself alone. Consider somebody else.
Yeah.
Amen. We need to have an attitude of caring for one another.
Yeah.
Amen. An attitude of encouraging one another.
Yeah.
Amen. Kindness to one another.
Yeah.
Amen. Humility to one another.
Yeah.
Unselfishness to one another.
Yeah.
Respectfulness. To one another. You gotta respect one another. Amen. Praise God. Amen. We just can't say I want the favor of God and treat one another wrong. Amen. The favor of God can be flowing like a rushing mighty wind. Amen. But then you start treating people wrong. Amen. The flow will stop. I believe it. All my heart. Amen. Praise God. We got to treat one another right. Amen. That's why as people of God, we don't need to be running our mouth talking about one. Praise God. Bad mouthing one another. Praise God. Praise God. Amen. Come on now. Amen. I said we got to love one another. Somebody sent me something today and the quote was this. It says, if the fruit of the Spirit will grow, the gifts of the Spirit will flow. And everybody want the gifts to flow, but there ain't going to be no gifts flowing until the fruit of the Spirit grow in our life.
Right.
Amen. Amen. Praise God.
Yeah.
Amen.
Yeah.
Amen.
Yeah.
Praise God. Yeah. Amen. And that wasn't original. Matter of fact, the preacher at General Conference that preached on Tuesday night made that statement.
Right.
Amen. That the fruit of the Spirit will grow. The gifts of the Spirit will flow. Amen. Amen. But we also got to respect too. We got to have some respect, or excuse me, some great attitudes toward authority.
Amen.
Amen. Amen. You can't just have a right attitude toward God and right attitude toward one another, but to authority you say, I ain't
right.
No, you got to have the right attitude even toward authority.
Amen.
Amen. Our attitude to authority should be that of respectfulness. Amen. Cooperativeness. You need to cooperate with authority. Not just the local authorities, but even the authority that God places in the church.
Amen.
Amen. To authority, spiritually speaking, there needs to be respect. There needs to be cooperativeness. There needs to be accountability. Amen. There needs to be humbleness. Amen. Respect, encouragement, loyalty. Amen. That's the kind of attitude you got to have to authority, not resentful.
Right.
Amen. Not defiant.
Right.
Amen. Or disrespectful. That even goes to children in the home. Amen. Amen. You got to have two authority. Your parents are your authority.
Amen.
Amen. I know these videos and cartoons and movies today want to make children and young people feel like I don't have to respect my parents. The devil is a lie.
Amen.
Amen. Praise God. Amen. There still needs to be yes, ma'am. Yes, sir.
Yes, sir.
Amen. Not huh?
Yeah.
What? No, 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 no. There needs to be some respect.
Yes, sir.
Amen.
Yes, sir.
Ma'am, what did you say?
Yes,
sir, what did you say?
Yes.
Amen.
Amen.
Come on now. Don't get you get quiet all you want.
Yes.
Amen. Yes. Amen. There needs to be a sense of respect to authority.
Yes.
Amen.
Amen.
Amen. What kind of attitude should we have toward hardship, difficulties, or hard circumstances? What attitude we need to have is that of being patient. Amen. When hard times and hard circumstances come, we need an attitude of thankfulness. Amen. We need the attitude that I'm going to persevere through what I'm going through. Amen. Now we in the mindset, we in an hour that when trouble come and hard times and difficult times come, the thing that people want to do is jump ship. Amen. Amen. Jump ship. Hey, I'm going somewhere else. Don't realize where you go, you're going to still have the same problems and the issue if you don't deal with it where you're at. Praise God. Amen. Like you jumping out of the fire into the frying pan. How is it from frying pan to the fire? I don't know, because I don't live by that mindset. Sometimes you just got to wait on God. Amen. Say, sometimes you just got to wait on God. Amen. Somebody, you know, that's the mindset we have of people today. Amen. Circumstances come that's difficult. I'm gone. See you later. Hear the papers. Sign them.
Yeah.
Yeah. Amen. Unreconcilable differences. Amen.
Amen.
We need some. Now don't pray for patience. just you're gonna deal with enough in life that you're gonna learn how to just be temperate, patient. Don't God send me patience. You get a whirlwind of things that'll come your way. Amen. Amen. We need to just sometimes when hard circumstances come, just learn to get an attitude of being thankful. Amen.
Right.
Just get an attitude, Lord, I'm just going to persevere, and I'm just going to have an attitude. I'm just going to keep believing you're going to work this situation out. That's the kind of attitude we need. Amen. And we need an attitude to our church. Amen.
Yes, sir.
Amen. Some people, their attitude toward the church is crazy.
Amen.
Amen. Amen. They look at the church like a social club.
Mm-hmm.
Amen. Amen. But the attitude to the church should be an attitude, again, of respectful. We need to respect the house of God.
Right.
Amen.
Amen.
Amen. Amen. We need to respect the house of God. Amen. We need to be faithful to the house of God.
Right.
We need an attitude of being faithful to the house of God.
Right.
Amen. An attitude of being helpful.
Amen.
To the house of God.
Amen.
An attitude of willingness toward that house of God.
Right.
An attitude of being dependable.
Yeah.
That ain't a curse word. Some people, dependable is like a bad word. Amen. God wants us to be dependable. We need to be dependable to the house of God.
Yes, sir.
Amen.
Yes, sir.
Amen. We need to come and participate. We need an attitude that I want to participate.
Yes.
Amen. And I want to be an encouragement in the house of God.
Yes, sir.
Amen.
Yes, sir.
Amen.
Yes,
sir. Don't have this attitude. I just don't want to be nothing. Amen. This is our church.
Yes, sir.
Amen.
Yes.
This is the body of Christ. We
yes.
need to care about the church.
Yes, sir.
Amen. You see some trash, don't just walk over and pick it up. Praise God. Somebody else gonna get it. Man, I pull up sometimes, see trash. I'm going getting something to pick it all up. And, you know, I ain't above picking up no trash.
Right.
Amen. I care about the church.
Right.
Amen. I ain't just waiting on somebody else to do it. And that ain't my responsibility. Amen. We all have a responsibility. Amen. Amen. Praise God. Amen. Amen. What should our attitude be to duty? To work? Our attitude should be that of faithfulness. Amen. Responsibilities. We need to have a responsible attitude. An attitude of obedience. Amen. Amen. Cooperation. Amen. Endurance. Amen. That's the kind of attitude we need. Amen. Because I'm here to tell you, we all going to have bad days. You know, I wish I could tell you once you get saved, you're just going to have all these good days. You're going to have some bad days. Amen. But what do you do when you have a bad day? You still press your way out. It means to say, I'm going to pause and digress for you 1 second. You ought to applaud yourself. You ought to thank yourself for just pressing your way to the house of God tonight. I commend you. Some of you had rough days. You've been dealing with some unruly kids in that classroom. Sometimes it's other teachers, other co-workers. Amen. And you could just easily just say, man, I have had enough. I'm just going home. I ain't doing nothing else. But you press your way to the house of God. I commend you for that. Amen. Amen. Give yourself another round of applause. For being faithful in the house of God. Amen. What should our attitude be to unfairness? Amen. What kind of mindset do you have when you're being treated unfairly? You should have an attitude, again, of just of temperance, patience, humility, an attitude that I'm going to be confident in God's judgment and God's justice. Amen. God is just. And I know I may be being treated unfairly right now, but I'm going to trust the Lord. Do you know God has a wonderful way of dealing with people's hearts? And they will say things and do things and don't even know why they're doing them. Because God is the Bible says the heart of the king is in the hand of the Lord. God knows how to deal with people's hearts. Amen. Do things for you and you be scratching your head. How in the world and why in the world are they doing this for me? It's favor. Amen. Amen. How do you deal with disappointment? What's the attitude should we have with disappointment and tragedy? Our attitude should be, again, submission to God. Attitude needs to be prayerful. We need to keep a prayerful attitude. When you're dealing with tragedy and difficulties, you just need to have an attitude that I got confidence in God's fairness. God is fair and he's just. And I'm going to trust him in this situation. I'm not going to get bitter. There are too many people get bitter in the world today. Amen. Don't let bitterness get in your spirit. Bitterness will destroy you. It will destroy you. It will stop the flow and the favor of God on your life. How do we deal with loss? The lost people of today's world. We need to have a certain kind of attitude to lost souls. Amen. We don't need to just look down on them and say, bless God, I'm saved. You need to get saved. Low down, sinner. No. We don't need to have that kind of attitude to sinners and lost people. We need to have an attitude of compassion. Amen. Forgiving. Helpful. We need to have an attitude. I want to somehow let God use me to be able to reconcile this person to God. Amen. We're not careful. We can get saved and look at the world and look at everybody that's not saved and judge them. Amen. Amen. We were in their shoes too. Amen. If it had not been for the grace of God, you might be in the same situation. I go to work, I ride by some of these homeless people, and sometimes they bring tears to my eyes. And I just go, I thank you. God, I thank you that I'm not in that kind of situation. Amen. But, if the Lord leads, I'll try to do something for them. If I'm walking by them, if the Lord leads. gotta be wise as serpent and harmless as doves.
That's right.
Everybody asking for money. They ain't asking it to just better themselves.
Right, right.
They asking for money to get drunk.
That's right.
Amen. They asking it to get high.
That's right.
Amen. And you need to be wise.
That's right.
Amen. I have a preacher friend of mine, he would give people money and he would say, now listen, what are you gonna do with this money? No, I'm just give me something to eat. He would say, listen, I'm a preacher. If I give you this money, you lying to a preacher. God will deal with you. You can leave it at that. You know, but you do need to be wise. Because you don't want to just pull your wallet out in front of somebody. So I need, you pull your wallet out and you pull it out and they grab it. They gone. It happened. You person, you open it up, look at my chain. Before you know it, you know, you feel something upside your head. The wallet gone, the purse gone, and you're trying to figure out where you was. You're saying we got to be wise. And I'm not saying don't help people. Amen. It's like times people come and say, I need some help. Well, we say, won't you come on in the service? I don't have time to sit in the service. Well, maybe you know, I just want to see if you're going to sit in the service. If you sit in the service, I may give you some money.
Right.
You know? But, amen. We did that for a lady not too long ago. Amen. She came, sat in the service. Amen. Got filled with the Holy Ghost. She got baptized. I'm sorry. Thank you. She got baptized. Amen.
Yeah, right.
But she was willing to stay.
Amen.
Amen. We just need wisdom.
Right.
Amen. How do we deal with sin? What should the attitude be to sin? Our attitude to sin should be, I'm not going to accept sin.
No.
Amen. I'm not going to compromise to sin.
Yeah.
Amen. Praise God. I don't have nothing to do with sin. Praise God.
Right.
Amen. Amen. That should be the attitude.
Amen.
If it's sinful, I won't have nothing to do with it.
Right.
Amen. If your friend's saying, come on, let's go do this, and you know it's sinful, I'm not doing it.
Right.
You can go if you want to go. I'm not going.
Amen.
I thought we was friends. We are friends, but I'm not going with you.
Right.
Amen. I'm not drinking that with you.
Amen.
Amen. Praise God.
Amen.
You got to stand your ground sometimes.
Amen.
Amen. Praise God. So you got to stand your ground.
Amen.
Amen. Everybody around the table, and they coming around with the bottles and the champagne and red wine, white wine. What would you like? Water.
Right.
I was at a dinner this week, and everybody come out, and everybody excited about the drinks. Thank God there was some that still stood their ground.
Amen.
Amen. What would you like? Water.
Right.
You know, not like. No. That's how some people. I like a glass of water.
Right.
You have Sprite.
Right.
Amen. And they take the glass wine off the table.
Yeah.
Amen.
Come on.
Praise God.
Come on.
Amen. And just because everybody else doing it.
Right.
Amen. 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 25 people probably, you know, 20 of them all were drinking.
Uh-huh.
Not me.
Yeah, that's right. That's right,
I'm not doing it.
That's right.
Amen. And then your flesh will get the feeling, well, I want to feel accepted. I ain't trying to be accepted in that group.
Amen.
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 Yeah,
because if you were drinking what I was drinking, shoo, you wouldn't want to drink that no more, praise God. I'm drinking heavenly wine, praise God. I don't care if it's free.
That's right.
Amen.
That's right.
Amen.
That's right.
How do we, what's the attitude to success? Our attitude towards success should be humility. When God start blessing you, stay humble.
Amen.
What's the attitude to success? You need to be grateful.
Amen.
You need to have an attitude. I am grateful.
Amen.
For where you have placed me. I am grateful for what you have done in my life.
Amen.
Amen. I want an attitude. I'm going to glorify God. I want God glorified.
Amen.
That's the kind of attitude. When God start opening doors, don't take no credit for yourself.
That's right.
Amen. All this is what I did. No, no. God opened this door. Amen. I am not about to forget God. Amen. The success I have, the things that I have, is because of Him. Amen. That's the kind of attitude. And I'm gonna tell you, when God sees that kind of attitude, He don't have a problem blessing you with more success.
All right, sir.
Amen. How do we have an attitude toward misunderstanding? Our attitude should be peacemaking. Amen. We need to be reconciliatory. Amen. To misunderstanding. We need to be forgiving to misunderstanding. Amen. We go on and on. But let me just close with this. How do we develop good attitudes? You know, it's easy to say have a good attitude, but how do you develop a good attitude? I'll tell you how you develop a good attitude. You identify and repent of bad attitudes. Amen. You got to identify and repent of bad attitudes. That's why Acts 8:22 says, repent, therefore, of this thy wickedness, and pray God, if perhaps the thought of thine heart may be forgiven thee. Amen. We're going to develop good, godly attitudes. You got to identify and repent of the bad ones. You ever had a bad attitude? You had to say, Lord, forgive me.
Yes, sir.
Amen. It's a dangerous place to have a bad attitude and get so numb. Your conscience is seared that you don't even realize I got a rotten, stinking, nasty attitude. My attitude is rotten. Amen. Thank God if you're married, you have a spouse that'll help you know when you got a bad attitude. Amen. There are times my wife will say, Damon, you know, okay, your attitude ain't right right now.
Thank you, Jesus.
Amen. And I have to realize, you know what? There are times she's right, and there are times she might be wrong. Amen.
Amen.
There's too much tea she was drinking. Say, what tea you drink last week? But you know you really got a bad attitude if somebody come and say, you know, your attitude bad. Something wrong with your attitude. Who you talking to? I ain't got no bad attitude. I think you got a bad attitude. Who you talking to? Oh, you remember what you did last week? Don't you talk to me about no bad attitude. Matter of fact, 10 years ago, to this day, you remember what you did? I'm talking about you want the favor to flow? What's wrong with you? What's wrong with me? Nothing wrong with me. You know something wrong.
Right.
You know, you'd be like, someone come to you like, are you touching me? And that's when the husband and wife is like, you know the wife. Somebody got a bad attitude. If I was just coming to my wife and say, hey, babe, what are you touching me for? It'd be like you'd be saying to your spouse, when the real person I know come back. Because that ain't the real person I'm talking to right now. See, I never have to really deal with that with my wife because she walk in the spirit. And I appreciate that.
Amen.
Amen. Sometimes that had to come out, though. Amen. We all got issues. Amen. Sometimes you work all day and you have a rough day and you come home and, you know, you thought you was going to drive it off and, you know, detox it and feel that long 30-minute ride and you just... All you did was ride 30 minutes and you still fuming about what happened. You know, you thought the ride was just going to be, you know, you're going to put on some good gospel music and you through the gospel music, you're still thinking about what happened. You still got it in the forefront of your mind. You get home and open the door. What are you doing? I'm just picking up my pencil to do my homework. Why you move that? Because I'm taking the dishes out of the dishwasher and putting them in the cabinet. We all need help sometimes. Amen. Last time I checked, I don't see nobody with no wings. And I'm closing. How do we develop a good attitude? We got to submit our attitude to God. You need to bring your attitude into obedience to God's word. You got to apply discipline to your thought life. You have to apply discipline to your thought life. There's sometimes you got to pull the reins like a horse on your thought life.
Yes.
Slow down, buddy. Your thoughts running wild right now. Slow down. Slow down. Pull the reins on your thought life.
Right.
Amen.
Amen.
If you don't, you be ready to slap somebody. I'll slap them and repent later. Amen. You got to understand that a good attitude is really nothing more than a matter of faith. It's disregarding your feelings with a determination to embrace God's outlook and God's disposition. That's why in closing, 2 Corinthians, let's all stand. Chapter 10, verse 5. Casting down imaginations and every high thing that exalted itself against the knowledge of God, and bringing into captivity every thought to the obedience of Christ. And lastly, if we're going to develop godly attitudes, good attitudes, we got to equip and feed our own attitudes. We got to feed your attitude. Feed it good stuff. Virtuous stuff. And that's what Paul said in Philippians 4:8. Finally, brethren, whatsoever things are true, whatsoever things are noble, whatsoever things are just, whatsoever things are pure, whatsoever things are lovely, whatsoever things are in good report, if there be any virtue, if there be any praise, think on these things. Amen. You got to think on the right things. Amen. So you got to think on the right things. Amen. See, the state of your attitude, the state of my attitude, is a choice. It's a choice. Therefore, you got to choose wisely. You got to get up a mindset. We got to get up a mindset. I'm going to refuse. Sometimes you just got to say, I refuse to be negative. I refuse to be angry all the time. I refuse to be a mean person who can always find something to complain about. Amen. Instead, fill your life with faith, hope, love, the things of God, and begin to realize God wants you to live your life with a sense of purpose, because you do have purpose. Amen. Lift your hands right now. Father, in the name of Jesus, God, we thank you. Thank God we're to watch particular areas in our life that are very critical, very important to us staying in right standing with you, allowing the true favor of God to flow in our life. I pray that God, you help us to watch our words. But I also pray that God, you would help us to watch our attitudes. I pray, God, you would help us, Lord, to daily ask as David did. Create in me a clean heart, O God. Renew a right spirit in me daily, God. I want my attitude to be pleasing in your sight. Help me on my job. Help me, God, in my school. Help me, God, daily. In the name of Jesus Christ, God, help me that I'm not so easily offended. Help me that I'm not so easily angered and upset about matters, God. I pray in the name of Jesus Christ. We love you. We thank you. We glorify you. Jesus Christ.
My mind.
My mind is made up.
Come on, let's make one big choir. Come on.
I am sold out. My mind is made up.
Come on, tell your neighbor, I'm sold out.
I am sold out. My mind is made up.
Come on, let's say it real loud. I'm sold out.
I am sold out.
Separate.
Who can separate us from the love of Jesus?
Come on.
Not death, nor life.
Come on, Jesus.
Jesus paid the price. Now I'm free from
sin. I'm sold out.